Hello, I'm Dr. John Iskander, and welcome to CDC Beyond the Data. I'm here today with Dr. George Luber, CDC's Chief of Climate Health. George, at today's Grand Round session, we heard about effects of climate and health. For example, we heard that many physicians are already reporting that their patients are seeing some of these effects. Very broadly, what kinds of effects are we talking about?
Sure, John. The impacts of climate change on health are varied. They range from the direct effects of extreme weather events, from heat waves and storms and floods, directly on people's health, but also indirectly through the changes that they incur on ecosystems, which they then again manifest on disease prevalence. So where areas that you wouldn't have had a particular disease, if climate change alters the temperature or the rainfall, you might get more of that disease in a particular area. Many of the health effects are health effects and diseases that we already encounter, but the amount of that disease and where we find them is going to change profoundly.
Okay, so just to give some examples of what you were just saying, we saw data about ozone increasing asthma attacks, but we're also seeing spread of certain types of agents that spread infectious diseases. Mm-hmm. Can you talk a little bit about some of those?
Absolutely. In the United States, we have a number of concerns related to vector-borne or insect-borne disease, to put it crudely. And those, the effects of climate change on that are very subtle. They range from the survivability of the insects over warmer winters. When winters are very cold, insects like beetles and ticks and mosquitoes die more easily. When winters are warmer, a higher proportion of those survive, increasing the base amount that reproduces throughout the following year. So we get an increase in the abundance of these insects that might cause disease, but we also get a change in their distribution, where they're found. As the frost line moves further north, as winters are warming in more northern climes, those insects are able to move into those areas. So we're seeing the ticks that spread Lyme disease occurring in northern in areas far north of where they had occurred previously. Our work with our grantees has shown that areas of Vermont and New Hampshire that never had the Ixodes tick that transmits Lyme now do have it. So we're seeing changes in where they're found and how much of those insects we find in a particular location.
So then we're seeing increases in the burden of chronic diseases. We're seeing increasing incidence or wider geographic spread of some infectious diseases. One of the interesting aspects of this session was even recognizing that mental health concerns can be related to climate change.
Absolutely. There's a number of dimensions in which mental health and sense of well-being are affected. If you live in a world of a degraded environment, perhaps you are less optimistic about the future. We call this the anticipatory mental health impact. Living in a world where the future prospects are quite dim by some regards, reading extreme climate projections, hasn't as shown to have an impact on younger kids. But more directly, the consequence of major natural disasters has been shown that there's a high burden of disease on mental health issues. Loss of community, loss of livelihood, loss of place, and also loss of family and other resources have a tremendous long-lasting impact on those individuals that are affected. So we see the direct mental health impacts of extreme weather events and also the more subtle effects of that living in a world of climate change brings.
So one of the reasons we chose to do this session was not simply to go through this list of different types of adverse impacts of climate change on health, but to recognize that there is something that we as a public health community can do about it. So what are we doing about it?
Absolutely. CDC and the Climate and Health Program at CDC is providing leadership on developing what we call adaptation plans for the public health sector. Our job in the Climate and Health Program is to prepare the nation's public health infrastructure to understand the impacts that climate change will bring in all the various areas of the United States. The experience that Florida will have and the challenges they will have will be substantially different than our colleagues in Maine or Oregon or Alaska, for the matter. So they need to be able to understand and interpret the climate science data, build into that an assessment of what are the vulnerabilities to those exposures. We're dealing with a range of exposures that are quite diverse, but in magnifying those exposures, and they will have dramatic impacts on those vulnerable communities. So assessing that vulnerability is quite key. We then match it to a disease burden projection using statistical methods to get a sense of what our future epidemiologic profile might look like. For example, our colleagues in the Northwest don't experience heat waves currently. But by looking at the climate models, they can see that their exposure to heat waves will increase dramatically in the future, actually in the near future. So they're putting systems in place right now to develop the capacity to prevent negative health outcomes of heat waves before they happen. We're looking into the future to understand what our future epidemiologic experience will be.
So right now, for example, coastal communities are going to be potentially more concerned about flooding, and maybe mm-hmm. inland areas more concerned about wildfires, but there's that need to, as you said, look forward as well. So I think one of the other important aspects of this session is that we're trying to make available a lot of the underlying science about climate change and health. Is there a particular key resource that people can seek out for that information?
Absolutely. You know, much of the material that we presented today was based upon the National Climate Assessment, actually the third U.S. National Climate Assessment, which is a report that is mandated by Congress, mandated by law, and it synthesizes the available evidence, the strength of the evidence as well, in the association between climate change and various impacts. And we assess it for health. We provide not only a synthesis of the available evidence, but in the back of the document, what we call a traceable account, which is our estimation of the quality and strength of the evidence supporting our claims, that provides a great resource for those interested in this topic. But the impacts of climate change don't end at our borders. Certainly there's global issues. And another document that was also released this year, which is the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, also known as IPCC, has another very similar process for synthesizing the evidence and reporting routinely. And their fifth assessment report was released this spring. CDC and our colleagues were authors on it as well. And that provides a global perspective on health and climate change, how the health outcomes will vary between developed and developing countries, for example.
So excellent resources.
Yes.
Thank you very much, George. Please join us next month for another episode of Beyond the Data.